some comments about a program that's involving men. That made me feel special, and I get to say a few words. So I really appreciate everybody participating in the program. I really do. So I want to introduce a very special man. I think we all know him. The founder of Jefferson Street Sound Museum, Lorenzo Washington.
Yay. Well, I'd like to thank everybody for being here. The ones that's not here, that's watching this video, I'd like to thank you for tuning in. This event in celebrations of men, and we do want to celebrate our men, especially the younger men, to let them know that they are important to our city, to our family, to ourselves. This event created by men, for men, will amplify, uplift, support, encourage, and reflect on men through photography, food, music, and discussion. And our first program presenter is one of my very good friends and a supporter of the Jefferson Street Sound Museum. Theme, Black Men in Labor and Music. And he's gonna speak on some of those theories. And Dr. Pierce is a curator at the National Museum of African American Music, and he's been very supportive of us here at the Jefferson Street Sound Museum. Matter of fact, we just took down an exhibit that he displayed at the National Museum of African American Music for. And he had it on display for 3 months. It gave us a lot of publicity. We had a number of people from the African American Museum to come and visit our museum over here on Jefferson Street. And I am so appreciative of all that he has done to help promote the Jefferson Street Sound Museum. And without further delay, I want to present Dr. Brian Pierce.
First, I want to say, oh, that's loud. First, I want to say just thank you to Ms. Karen and Mr. Lorenzo. It's been a joy to work on different projects with you, and every time I come here, I feel like home, even though I'm away from my home and my parents in Georgia, so thank you. I'm gonna keep this a little bit informal, and it can be conversational a little bit. When they approached me about talking about a subject matter as far as men, and I always want to talk about the hard work aspect of being a musician as far as black men, because I think there's a lot of struggle and a lot of conflict that takes place, especially with the younger generation as far as how can I maintain my place in society, be a respectful young man, and also do the same and be a musician, an artist, but how can I provide for my family also? And I think for the past, I say, 1865, starting on getting off that plantation, we've always had this kind of like, I want to express myself, but I have a family to take care of also, and I have that on my shoulders. So I want to explore that a little bit with the presentation, and we could be brief while we're going to talk, but I'm going to go through it pretty quickly. So I'm going to show pictures off my computer. I'm going to start off by explaining our museum. This is a photo of our museum. Probably everybody here has been there before. The main thing to know about our museum is the fact that we're based on five different galleries. And it starts with Wading the Water and ends with the message. I spoke about it yesterday. Our museum is not based on genre. It's based on concepts and ideas as far as music. And I think it's a good thing that's not based on genre, because it's all about that movement, that pattern that African Americans have made from that plantation and going to cities, because even I know my family, we started off in White Springs, White Pond, Alabama, that is a community of like 60 black folks. And they moved to Eufaula, Alabama, the big city, 6,000 folks. So the African American community has made many transitions to look for opportunities to be better, even if it was going to work in the factory or driving trucks and buses when respectful. That was ways that black men were able to provide for their families. And oftentimes, my father and the gentleman I just met go to the military. That's an option. But sometimes it's not always looked up as respectful as a musician or an athlete, someone making big money, but you're still providing for your family. So I think the thing is that striving, especially that urbanization of the African-American community, coming to big cities and finding opportunities in the arts, that's there. But at the same time, even men in, let's say, Memphis, Tennessee, saying, I am a man specifically, and I am a sanitation worker. And sometimes they're not even viewed as men just because that industry is hard work, where someone else could just be working as well and get so much more respect. But again, I think that it's finding that balance. And I think that's the whole point, where sometimes that support hasn't always been there. And I think if we fast forward to today, I look at with some people, and then specifically even I look at country music right now, there's this big focus to include African Americans in that voice of country music, where you see a lot of African-American women getting opportunities as far as in country music. Men not completely, but I'm very proud of those strides that women have made. This next slide is actually a video, and I want to show it. It's a video of our newest exhibit that came down right after Miss Lorenzo Washington's video. Amazing exhibit that I enjoy so much. But this is an exhibit of Allison Russell that's right in our gallery at this point. And I'm really proud of it. The young lady's from Canada. She came here and she worked for 18 years on the road as a hard working musician. And she's now receiving her flowers as far as the work that she's doing within the community. And also as a Canadian American black woman. And I'm proud of what she's doing. So in even saying that, with the exhibition, what we're always trying to do, or exhibits, we're trying to educate the public and showcase the opportunities and what's available for people as far as music and what they've done as far as being trailblazers. And we've done that with multiple exhibits in the past. And I specifically look at this as far as there's two stories I want to talk about. One is that whole movement in 1945 all the way up until about 1960, where so many African Americans were specifically leaving those plantations. Some of them just came back from World War II. And they were finding those opportunities in places like Memphis to become musicians on Beale Street. Or they were finding places on Jefferson Street being musicians in the clubs. And they weren't generating the revenue they had, but at the same time, they were working hard jobs to provide for their families. And then sometimes we don't often see that. We just see the success. And then I think those ideas of being artists for the sake of art, a lot of young men don't realize the people that have been those trailblazers, even in the education field, that taught these schools, they did for the love of that generation, for the people that come after them. And it wasn't always about this quick, expedient, we're going to get paid, we're going to get money. No, it was the love of art for music. And also, they were working hard being a sanitation worker, working in grocery stores, picking up people's garbage. My grandfather worked 30 years cutting, not in a bad way, the rich white people, you follow Alabama's grass. And he provided for 6 girls to go to college, though. So, I mean, those are the stories that we need to appreciate and recognize. It's that hard work that goes along with chasing your dream. So, and then that's the reason why I'm going to tell the story of one young man that I mentored. His name is Christopher Wallace. I love him dearly. I watched that young man grow up while I was in college, and I'm so proud of him. And then he's like, Brian, yo, you doing your thing in college. You play in bands, and like you're going to school. I'm proud of you, brother. I want to be just like you. I was like, all right, cool. But there's sacrifices. I don't have kids. I don't have a wife. I mean, like, I eat ramen noodles. Like, you need to recognize that, brother. It's cool and everything. I enjoy it, but I sacrifice. And he said, yeah, but, yo, I'm going to get me a Grammy. I was like, cool, but that's not guaranteed. So I was really happy with him. I worked with his sister. We got him in college. He went to Central Oklahoma University. They have a beautiful music program there. She was actually working in the finance department at the time there. And then he worked his butt off. Excuse me. He worked himself hard. And I was so proud. He graduated. But he did end up getting a young lady pregnant. And he ended up marrying her. I was so happy for him. But he still had the aspirations of being a rapper. And I was like, yo, you have this music production degree right now. It's okay to be a sound engineer in the studio. Like, while you're chasing your dream, just get a regular job in the studio, mix people's music, and then provide for your wife and your child right now. Like, there's no shame that, no, I'm going to perform out. Like, I'm going to tour. I'm like, all right, brother, but, like, think about what you're doing. And I was like, child number 2 came, and he's still chasing that dream. I was like, brother, like, your wife has 2 children right now, and then she just got a nursing degree. She's working full time. You need to kind of like be a part of that story also. And then he did get a job, but it's like, it's not about sacrifice. But sometimes those hard things you have to make, those hard choices, especially when child number 3 and child number 4 comes also. For Miss Wallace. He's now 32. And he does well, but the thing is, I think those are the things when you're talking about being a musician and an artist. You always have to keep your heart as far as you have a family. You have kids that look up to you. Your wife works really hard. You're always doing a dynamic job. But you have to find that balance in yourself where you're chasing that dream, but at the same time, you're providing the best that you can for your family. So this last slide that I'm going to show is from an exhibit that we had part of our hip-hop exhibit. I think some people might know, this is Master P. This is Master P, and that's Silk the Shocker. He was a big rapper also off No Limit Records. Now, this was actually in our exhibit last year in springtime for the hip-hop exhibit. And this is a special photo of me. Now, this pink building behind you, it's actually Master P's store in Richmond, California. Master P was chasing his dream, but he did a lot of sacrifice that a lot of people don't know. And then even though he really was, like, he's a musician, he was a businessman. He focused on making his money the right way, selling CDs out of this little pink building in Richmond, California. You see the West Coast Bad Boys. He was in another different city, another different state, working hard day after day, selling CDs, producing people in the back, wasn't making big money. But no one ever saw this. All they saw was Master P in 96 and 97 going, on a big tank. And they were like, all right, overnight since, no. It was hard work, a lot of sacrifice that a lot of people don't see. This man, you're going to make fun of him, like, oh, no, he worked hard. And I think that's the thing that we need to recognize. It's not that immediacy sometimes when it comes to music. Sometimes you might have to even work on that plantation, picking cotton, and then playing that guitar at the same time at nighttime. So I think that's the whole focus is, it might not... But as long as you keep your heart true, it can happen. So that's my talk. I was going to keep it short, but we do have options out there. It's just let's do the best that we can as black men and as black people. Thank you.